Stéphane m'avait dit que il m'a invité à parler du rôle de Pierre dans ce qui s'appelait à l'époque le DEA champ particules matière, dit CPM, puis dans la création d'APC. De fait, sans la venue de Pierre au DEA champ particules matière, il n'aurait probablement pas demandé sa mutation à Paris Diderot pour devenir directeur d'APC. Je vais être bref, parce que le rayonnement scientifique de Pierre a été décrit par bon nombre d'entre vous. Je m'en tiendrai au contrat que j'ai passé avec Stéphane, qui n'est pas tout à fait ce qu'il a dit, c'est-à-dire, ce que je viens de vous dire, c'est-à-dire de raconter des souvenirs qui datent d'avant la création d'APC. Alors, j'ai connu Pierre, je vais dire sur le plan humain, immédiatement après sa nomination de prof à Orsay. J'étais allé le rencontrer pour lui proposer de prendre le cours de théorie de jauge. Immédiatement, il a mordu à l'hameçon, il est tout de suite précipité, séduit par l'idée d'attirer vers la physique théorique quelques étudiants bien formés dans les méthodes expérimentales et les techniques instrumentales. Un autre aspect, un indice qui m'avait échappé lors de notre première rencontre, c'est qu'il me rappellerait lors d'un dernier déjeuner ensemble, c'est que, il avait été frappé par le nombre d'étudiants de CPM qui choisissaient comme module optionnel la cosmologie observationnelle, c'est-à-dire allant théorie de la gravitation aux particules prédites par, enfin, disons, hors modèle standard. Les anciens étudiants de CPM, quand je les rencontre, qu'ils soient expérimentateurs ou théoriciens, tarissent pas d'éloges sur le talent de Pierre dans ses cours et puis sur son charme si particulier. Quand j'ai quitté la direction d'APC, pas d'APC, quand j'ai quitté la direction de CPM, je n'ai pas, il n'a pas existé, c'est plutôt lui qui n'a pas existé un seul instant pour faire tandem avec Yves Charron pour prendre ma suite. Bon, par contre, je le dis tout de suite, pour l'amener à être directeur d'APC, j'en ai plutôt bavé. C'était, comme il dirait, déployer des terajoules. Vous allez le voir tout de suite. Lorsque j'ai eu le feu vert, donc, pour restructurer ou refonder, comme on voudra l'appeler, la physique de Paris Diderot, en trois laboratoires connus sous le sigle, donc APC, MPQ, MSC, j'ai tout de suite pensé à Pierre pour venir contribuer à la création d'APC et, si possible, en prendre à terme la direction. Un autre aspect, un autre exemple de son tempérament, on est tout de suite tombé d'accord, il a été tout de suite d'accord pour, disons, partager mon credo. Décloisonner la physique, équilibrer recherches fondamentales et appliquées, insérer dans des laboratoires à fond de composantes expérimentales des théoriciens, choisir trois thèmes pour chacun de ces laboratoires pour qu'ils soient professionnels sur peu plutôt qu'amateurs sur tout. Dans le cas d'APC, ce que je suggérais, c'était comme thème, c'est du reste, je pense, ce qui a été plus ou moins respecté, cosmologie observationnelle, astrophysique des hautes énergies et physique des neutrinos. Malgré ça, Pierre n'a accepté de mes propositions que d'être membre, un membre extérieur parmi tant d'autres, du conseil scientifique de l'UFR de physique. Bon, il n'a accepté que ça, c'était par scrupule, parce il avait été nommé professeur à Paris 7, à Paris 11, pardon, à Orsay, et qu'il ne voulait pas, il devait jouer un grand rôle au laboratoire de physique théorique d'Orsay. Donc il avait un cas de conscience à venir tout de suite. Donc il a préféré passer par le conseil scientifique et venir comme membre extérieur. Alors, s'il faut peut-être que je dise que ce conseil avait pour mission à ce moment-là de flécher le maximum de postes vers les trois laboratoires à créer et de répartir les crédits d'installation. Comme l'université, ça, il faut peut-être le dire pour beaucoup d'entre vous, l'université Paris Diderot avait été créée en 1972. Elle était en plein milieu, au tout début plutôt, pas en plein milieu, des prises de retraite massives dans ces laboratoires. Par exemple, l'UFR de physique a pu bénéficier d'environ 20 postes pour elle-même par an, pendant un minimum de 6 ans, et presque autant venant du CNRS. Dès la première année de son mandat au conseil scientifique de l'UFR de physique, Pierre découvrant que finalement, ça se passait comme je lui avais dit, c'est-à-dire que au grand cri des 14, il y avait à ce moment-là 14 laboratoires dans l'UFR de physique, et que tous les postes avaient été pris à ces laboratoires, ils n'étaient pas redéployés vers ces laboratoires, ils n'étaient pas réaffectés à ces laboratoires, mais redéployés vers les trois créés. Donc, voyant que ça se passait comme ça, pragmatique et ambitieux pour APC, il a posé sa candidature pour prendre la direction d'APC, où, après avoir été muté à Paris 7, enfin, il a eu sa mutation à Paris Diderot, un an après, il était nommé directeur d'APC. Dans l'intervalle, nous avions négocié ensemble des contrats de collaboration avec le CEA, puis après, vous connaissez la suite, tout le succès qu'il a eu dans la gestion la mise en route du laboratoire APC. Vincent Berger, qui est devenu ensuite un des présidents de Paris 7, Vincent Berger et François Gallet, qui étaient les directeurs pressentis respectivement de MPQ et de MSC, les deux autres laboratoires, se sont entendus à merveille avec Pierre pour se répartir équitablement la manne des postes et les copieux crédits d'installation. Tous deux, ils ne sont pas là, mais je peux témoigner pour eux qu'ils ont été remplis d'admiration tout de suite pour Pierre et qu'ils l'ont gardé cette admiration jusqu'à maintenant, bien entendu. Bon, je n'ai laissé entrevoir ici que quelques traits du tempérament de Pierre. Pour aller plus loin, je dirais simplement que nous partageons aussi bien d'autres choses, en particulier un goût partagé, donc de la musique, même si Pierre préférait l'opéra et moi la musique de chambre. Au total, on l'aura compris, le primordial aura été pour nous notre amitié indéfectible. Bien sûr, mais ça, on ne peut pas parler en 5 minutes, ni même en 10. Alors, merci Pierre pour ces moments inoubliable, vécu dans l'action comme dans la méditation et la détente. Merci de m'avoir entendu.
Give the talk in English, so let's continue it. Yeah, so just before starting my talk about and talking about the MOOC itself, I just to say that my first contact with Pierre was 14 years earlier, that is in 2004, when I just got my PhD and was looking for a position at the CNRS, and Pierre was the member of the Commission Interdisciplinaire, if you remember, at that time. And so I interacted with him at that occasion. Finally, I did not get the position, but 1 year later, I was recruited as an assistant professor here at the university, and I was working at the APC, working on the LISA project on gravitational wave detection from space. Maybe I was recruited because I did not know anything about that at that time. Probably we were not so many, there were not so many people knowing about gravitational wave detection from space at that time anyway. So that's how I started to know Pierre, and that from that time on, I worked with him on a daily basis on LISA. At that time, Pierre was already a strong promoter of the LISA project, and he remained so until his passing 1 year ago. Well, so that was in 2005. 10 years later, so in 2015, I also had the opportunity to participate with other persons to the MOOC, that is a massive open online course built by Pierre about gravitation. The motivation for building such a course, a very general public course on gravitation, was for Pierre basically to share his knowledge and also his excitement of opening a new science field. But actually, the best way is to hear him talking about it, which will start.
Okay, so you know, first motivation was that, well, personally, is that, you know, I'm involved in the very large program, the LISA mission, you know, which will extend over 20 years, 30 years, which will be very costly, about 2 billion euros. And I thought it was natural to sort of give back, you know, what we're doing, and also to explain what we're doing, not just through some, you know, outreach, you know, to some, you know, conferences of 1 hour, but to sort of build a community that would be following, you know, what we're doing, and get involved, and get involved not just in the results, but in the. In the excitement of a discovery, in the expectations, and all that. So, you know, that's what we've been trying to do. That's why we've been involving you in the launch of you know, missions, in trying to make you meet some of the, you know, key people in the field, and so on. I must say we have been served by, you know, what has been happening over the last months. We didn't expect that would, you know, go so fast. But I was also expecting that it was a new, whole new field that was opening up with, you know, completely a revolutionary type of observations. And so it was an idea to prepare the ground for, you know, sharing the excitement. So that's, you know, the first motivation for it. You know, I think, again, we have been, you know, very well served by, you know, the circumstances.
So I think this video, which was shot actually in 2016 when there were some participants of the MOOC coming here to meet the researchers. Well, this video shows basically the will of Pierre of sharing his excitement and yes, his passion for gravitational wave and his research. Well, this MOOC had some ambitious goals. It was basically to explain gravitation with no equation at all, from Galileo to Einstein, talking about cosmology and gravitational waves. Well, just a few facts. It was basically 6 weeks of lectures, basically 5 short lectures per week. There were 5 editions of this MOOC, 2 in French, 2015, 2016, and 3 in English called Gravity in 2015, 2016, and the last one last year in 2017. Well, 6 weeks of lectures meant basically 9 months of preparation, probably 9 months of full time for a few persons, full time for Pierre, but we all know that Pierre was able to have many full time jobs at the same time. And one of them was a MOOC.
Can I understand general relativity? Why is the universe expanding? What is dark energy? And what is the information contained in the first light emitted right after the Big Bang? Why is the universe hot and dense after the Big Bang? How do I know that a gravitational wave is passing through a room? Cross or not to cross the horizon of a black hole? Is it a question? If you want to know why, if you want to know how, and much more, please join us on the MOOC Gravity on FutureLearn.
So you see the scope of this MOOC, and, well, pretty ambitious, I should say. Well, this MOOC was general public, and it was, it's little to say, a great success. I just collected some numbers that was given to me by Mary, and she. So that's basically the number of people participating to this MOOC over the 5 editions. About 100,000 person registered to follow this MOOC over the five editions. Among them, about 35,000 followed the first lecture, and 9,000 were still there at the end. That's 25%. That's actually amazingly high for that kind of very general public MOOC dealing with topics that are not so easy to understand. And you see that attendees were, well, young. Some of them were very young, some less young. So 8 from to 88 years old. And the participants were also from all over the world. That's a map showing in different shades of blue the number of participants from the different countries in the world. And I think that there are more countries with blue than without. That means that you have, I mean, only a few countries did not know about the MOOC probably of Pierre. And that's only for the last one last year. Of course, if we compile from all the years, we probably covered more or less the whole world. One originality of this MOOC was that actually it at some point went from virtual world to real life. About 80 participants were invited to come here at Paris Diderot to meet the researchers working on gravitational wave detectors and gravitational wave field in the gravitational field, and also to meet Pierre in particular. Most of the participants came from France, obviously, but not only, and I have the example of a Dutch farmer who followed the MOOC and took specifically a few holidays to come here. And he had a passion for astrophysics and cosmology and just wanted to know more about it and was so enthusiastic about the MOOC that he came here to see where science was going on. And remember, so this gravitational wave fiesta was taking place in early 2016. That is a couple of weeks after the announcement of the first detection of gravitational waves. Well, actually, that was the occasion of this meeting, just following the detection. So, virtual world to virtual to real world.
So I was just saying that it's good to we are sort of doing the other way around from everybody else. Usually you go from real to virtual reality. We are doing the opposite. We started virtual and now we meet you in reality. So that's a pleasure to meet some of you. I must say that whenever I meet someone who followed the course. Okay, they have the impression they know me because they had to go through many hours of lectures. But strangely enough, I have the impression to know you. So that's an interesting aspect. Okay.
So you see that doing this MOOC, teaching in this MOOC was not one-way teaching. It's also so very, very good for teachers because we learn about, the attendees and the and people participating. That was a very, very nice moment. That was the MOOC. You can say everything was going very well, very fine, but also a MOOC has a dark side. I see, the dark side of the MOOC. But, you know, we are talking about cosmology and astrophysics, and dark things sometimes are much welcome in cosmology. You probably know about it.
One comment. It was in the French course, and that is directly related to what Catherine was saying. One day we received a message in the course, in the forum of discussion, which was entitled, because on the EDX platform you have titles to your comments, and it was saying the dark energy of this MOOC. So I was very worried because last we had a message that was causing a problem, and I was wondering what this dark energy was. And it was a beautiful message saying, okay, there are a few, couple of thousand people who are exchanging ideas and comments, in the forum of discussion. But there is a dark part of the participants, which is the majority, who are never expressing themselves, but who are enjoying reading and all the comments and using them for understanding things. And so this is what he was calling the dark side, of this course. And in the end, he was thanking the whole team for on behalf of the dark side of the course. And we really. That went straight to our heart, and that was a very nice message that we received.
To conclude, I would say that the MOOC is also some different ways of teaching to the general public, teaching through modern media, teaching through internet and digital media support. However, teaching, the heart of teaching is basically also to have the ability to react and to answer in any circumstance, especially when the teacher is wrong.
If Elisa had been in the sky, could we have detected simultaneously these gravitational waves? Si Elisa avait été dans le ciel, aurions-nous pu observer ces ondes gravitationnelles? Ok, avec ce détecteur aussi, je ne dis pas la même chose en français et en anglais. I'm saying different things in French and in English. So, okay, so that's a way. Now we are going to test, the English speakers and the French speakers, because the answer is different.
So that will just conclude. We'll conclude on the laugh of Pierre. And I think you all know that he was a very gifted teacher. It was also the case for this MOOC, and it was a great experience to work with him on this project. Thank you. I will also thank Marie and Jean-Luc, who worked very hard on this MOOC to prepare all these lectures and gave me all the material needed for this presentation. Thank you very much.
Je suis très émue de me retrouver dans cette salle parce que. Si vous saviez comme vous tous, enfin toute cette communauté que vous représentez ici m'a apporté pour ma vie entière et j'ai envie de le communiquer au public. Et alors quand on se retrouve devant par exemple, j'apprends 2010-2011 que l'Europe va produire une image comme le fond diffus de l'univers. L'image du fond diffus de l'univers, l'image de Planck. Mais ma parole, c'est quand même l'image de la naissance de l'univers. Je me dis, mais comment je vais faire passer ça vers mon public? C'est une nouvelle extraordinaire. C'est une aventure de l'humanité extraordinaire. Mais comment le faire passer? Quand on dit à quelqu'un dans la rue, les scientifiques, ils ont pris la photo de l'univers en train de naître, regarde avec des yeux ronds. Comment est-ce possible de prendre la photo d'un événement qui s'est produit il y a 13 milliards 800 millions d'années? C'est pas possible. Donc le message est difficile à faire passer. Et j'étais en face de ce dilemme. Comment, avec mes chroniques de 3 minutes, pouvais-je faire passer vers le public un message aussi fondamental pour l'histoire des sciences, pour l'histoire de l'humanité. Alors bien sûr, il y avait déjà eu l'image de Kobe une dizaine d'années avant, ou peut-être même plus. Il y en avait eu une deuxième aux États-Unis, mais là c'était l'Europe qui la produisait. Et puis ça allait être une image encore plus belle, encore plus précise, qui allait nous apprendre des choses encore plus extraordinaires sur ce qui s'est passé au tout début de l'histoire de l'univers. Comment faire passer ça? Alors, j'ai réfléchi, je me dis, le seul moyen, c'est de faire une fête. De faire une fête autour de la naissance de l'univers. Alors je voyais déjà des danseurs, des feux d'artifice, des tas de choses extraordinaires. Je me disais, cette image, il faut la projeter sur les plus beaux endroits du monde, sur les chutes du Niagara. Faut que ce soit aussi grandiose que la découverte. Alors j'en parle autour de moi, je peux vous dire que j'ai pas eu beaucoup de réactions, sauf le jour où je croise Michel Spiro dans une occasion tout à fait un peu comme ici. Et il avait exprimé l'idée, il était à l'époque, Michel Spiro était à l'époque président du conseil du CERN, et il avait exprimé l'idée que toute cette physique des particules, si difficile aussi à communiquer vers le grand public, l'art pouvait peut-être servir. Donc à la sortie de cette réunion, je suis allée le voir, j'ai dit j'ai une idée. Et donc, je voudrais faire un spectacle autour de l'image de Planck qui doit nous arriver en 2012. On était en 2011. Et il me dit, ouais, ça m'intéresse. Alors, bon, je vous passe après la suite pour arriver au fait. Mais en tout cas, c'est grâce à Michel Spiro qui, à ce moment-là, en tant que président du Conseil du CERN, m'a dit, y a une chose intéressante qui va se passer, c'est que le boson de Higgs va sans doute être découvert à peu près en même temps que la production de l'image du fond diffus. C'est-à-dire que tout d'un coup, la science de l'infiniment grand et les sciences de l'infiniment petit, comme on essaye de les rapprocher ici dans ce laboratoire de la PC, allaient concrètement se rapprocher. Alors, Michel Spiro me dit, ok, vas-y, toute seule. Hein. Donc, j'invite quelques copains scientifiques, quelques copains artistes, et puis on imagine, on rêve sur un spectacle grandiose, extraordinaire. Puis, quand le spectacle a été imaginé, on va au CERN, présenté par Michel, bien sûr, qui dit, oui, on va en faire un projet européen. Alors moi, je vous rendais compte, comme j'étais fière, mon ego en a pris plein. Mais la suite est beaucoup plus compliquée, on n'a pas eu l'argent qu'il fallait. Bon, bref, le spectacle ne s'est jamais fait, mais il a été remplacé par un événement européen aussi, la Nuit des Origines, qui se déroulait à Paris, Genève et en Italie. Et moi, j'avais été chargée de préparer l'événement à Paris, à l'UNESCO, où j'avais réuni tous les scientifiques qui avaient travaillé sur et la découverte du boson de Higgs et l'image du fond diffus. Et là, j'avais été les voir les uns après les autres, et il y avait Pierre dans le lot. Et là, j'avais été les voir les uns après les autres, et je leur avais dit à tous ces grands qui avaient tellement de choses à nous dire, vous aurez 5 minutes, pas plus. Et ben ça, vous savez, c'est pas facile de convaincre là. Ils ont tous joué le jeu admirablement. Ça a été une soirée extraordinaire dans la grande salle de l'UNESCO, avec 1000 personnes, et qui étaient enchantés par le fait que les chercheurs qui avaient contribué à tous ces grands résultats leur parlaient directement dans le plaisir, dans le rire. Il y a eu énormément d'humour. Tout le monde a ri. Il y avait une joie dans cette soirée extraordinaire. J'avais installé autour des scientifiques des jeunes de 93. Qui faisait partie d'une petite association qui avait été créée par des jeunes scientifiques pour essayer d'amener tous ces jeunes à aimer les sciences. Ils étaient assis autour des chercheurs. Et on a eu le temps de leur faire poser que 2 questions à la fin. Mais c'était 2 questions fabuleuses. Bref, c'était une soirée merveilleuse. Mais on n'avait pas fait le spectacle. Donc, après cela, avec Michel Spiro, nous avons créé une association avec l'idée de faire un spectacle. Mais alors là, c'était vraiment rentrer dans une aventure, je n'imaginais pas du tout ce que ça allait être. Et la pierre a apporté énormément, énormément. Alors, donc, moi, ce que je voulais, c'était que ce soit les scientifiques qui racontent. Le problème, c'est qu'un spectacle, pour le rentabiliser, pour le faire tourner, on ne peut pas faire tourner des scientifiques comme des acteurs. Donc, il fallait les faire intervenir par un autre moyen. Et là, on a fait appel à l'art numérique. Nous étions en partenariat avec le CDA, le Centre des Arts d'Enghien-les-Bains, qui est spécialisé dans les arts numériques. Et donc, là, s'adjoint... et là, avec Michel Spiro, on s'était dit, on va faire un spectacle autour du vide quantique, c'est-à-dire plus impossible à faire, on pouvait pas mieux. Alors, donc, on se lance dans cette affaire. On demande à Pierrick Sorin, je ne sais pas si vous connaissez Pierrick Sorin, mais c'est un artiste spécialisé dans les arts numériques et en particulier dans les petits théâtres optiques. C'est-à-dire que il vous filme, par exemple, et puis il vous met dans une petite mise en scène et on vous voit bouger en 3D. C'est des effets optiques qu'il arrive à obtenir. Ça a un charme fou, c'est drôle, c'est très amusant. Donc, toute cette technique, il nous l'a apportée. Et je voulais aussi que le corps soit présent, que ça ne soit pas qu'un événement pour la tête. Je voulais que ce vide quantique, ça soit aussi un événement pour le corps. C'était un rêve, hein, évidemment. Mais ce rêve... on voulait le faire exprimer par la danse, l'acrobatie. Et puis, par exemple, Sandrine Laplace, qui est une physicienne qui travaillait au CERN, on lui a demandé, pour le spectacle, tourné par Pierrick Sorin, puis reprojeté ensuite pour le spectacle avec les danseurs qui étaient en live, on lui a dit, tu te plonges dans le vide quantique et tu dis ce que tu ressens. Elle a très bien fait. Elle a très, très bien fait. Donc, ça a été une expérience absolument... on a plongé, quoi. On ne savait pas où on allait. Moi, je ne me rendais pas compte à quel point tout ça était compliqué, en fait. Et ce qu'il y avait de plus compliqué, c'était que les scientifiques s'impliquent. Parce qu'ils n'ont pas le temps, les scientifiques. Ils sont vous le savez tous, vous courez tout le temps. Donc, vous n'avez pas le temps. Là, quand on rentre dans cet aspect artistique où il faut faire vivre ses émotions, faire vivre son corps, et essayer de marier tout ça avec cette magnifique tête que vous avez, eh ben, c'est compliqué. Et eh bien, Pierre l'a magnifiquement joué. Et alors... et c'était là où moi j'ai trouvé que Pierre était une personnalité tout à fait exceptionnelle, parce que il s'est prêté au jeu, mais d'une façon, si vous voulez, dès le début il a été là, avec sa modestie. Le mot modestie a été très souvent employé pour le décrire, mais là c'est le même cas, c'est-à-dire il parlait très peu, mais quand il intervenait, c'était toujours avec énormément de tact et d'intelligence, bien sûr. Et puis, il nous a permis d'avoir une salle ici à l'APC pour que je puisse organiser des rencontres entre scientifiques et artistes qui ont permis d'avoir des dialogues tout à fait intéressants. Donc, tout ça, petit à petit, tout ça s'est mis en place et le spectacle s'est fait. Et le rôle que Pierre, son rôle s'est imposé de lui-même, puisqu'il était tellement présent, tellement là, mine de rien, que je lui ai dit, est-ce que tu aurais le temps de venir à Nantes pour un tournage avec Pierrick Sorin dans son atelier? Et c'était quand même toute une journée, on sait combien une journée coûte cher pour vous. Donc il est venu. Et il a tourné la première partie, le lancement, si vous voulez, de ce spectacle qui a donc été projeté au mois de septembre 2013. Mais c'était un tournage qui se faisait auparavant. Il y avait beaucoup de live sur scène, mais les scientifiques, c'était que du tournage. Donc je vous propose de voir cette première partie du spectacle.
Le vide, c'est tout, c'est partout, et c'est tout le temps.
Le vide, c'est un tout qui a l'air de rien.
C'est un spectacle qui a duré environ 40 minutes, qui nous a coûté la peau des fesses, excusez-moi de l'expression, mais il n'y en a pas d'autre pour exprimer à quel point ça coûte cher. Un spectacle comme ça pour 40 minutes, non, mais même 20 minutes, c'était 20 minutes. Et donc ça veut dire que c'était une erreur, en fait. mais l'expérience était passionnante. Et on en parlait avec Pierre, et alors Pierre m'a quand même dit une phrase qui m'a vraiment scotché après pour le reste de l'aventure. C'est qu'il m'a dit, mais tu sais, j'ai l'impression que la recherche artistique, c'est comme la recherche scientifique. On part vers des directions très compliquées, très complexes, on se prend le mur. Ça vous renvoie dans une autre direction, beaucoup plus simple, et c'est là qu'on rencontre ce qu'on cherchait. Et je pense que ça, pour moi, ça a été une grande leçon. Je l'ai toujours. Je sais pas si vous avez cette expérience-là de la recherche scientifique, mais en tout cas, c'est ce que Pierre m'a enseigné. Pour terminer, je voudrais quand même dire qu'il y a eu une suite à tout ça. Le spectacle n'étant pas possible pour des questions d'argent. Nous avons donc, avec toujours Michel Spiro, créé des labos Origins, qu'on appelle des labos Origins. Donc, c'est les scientifiques sont sur scène et les artistes aussi. Donc, ce sont chaque fois des one-shots sur des thèmes et on essaye, mais c'est très compliqué parce que c'est toujours des questions de temps, faire travailler ensemble artistes et scientifiques, mais c'est vraiment beaucoup du live. Mais il y a toujours de la magie. C'est plus ou moins, ça tricote plus ou moins bien, mais il y a toujours de la magie. Et on continue, si vous voulez en voir les résultats. Alors bon, ben Pierre aussi, là encore, il a été génial, parce que au moment des ondes gravitationnelles, il y avait la scène nationale de Blois qui nous avait proposé de faire un Labo Origins, et on s'était dit, oui, parce qu'on essaye d'être dans l'actualité aussi avec les Labo Origins, d'en faire un sur les ondes gravitationnelles, et on avait organisé un petit week-end de rencontres entre scientifiques et artistes. C'était quelque temps avant son décès. Pierre est venu. Il a été merveilleux pour raconter les ondes gravitationnelles. Il nous a beaucoup, beaucoup, beaucoup appris. Aux artistes qui étaient là également, qui se sont servis de son enseignement pour reproduire sur la scène nationale de Blois leur art. Enfin bon, voilà. Et puis, peu de temps après cette réunion, et bon, il m'envoie un petit mail en disant « Je dois être opéré à peu près à la date... Du spectacle à Blois, donc je ne pourrais pas venir. » Voilà. Voilà Pierre, à quel point il a été présent dans toute cette aventure. Si elle vous intéresse, je vous conseille d'aller voir sur le site Laborigins, en un mot, Laborigins, en un mot, .fr. Et vous verrez tout ce qu'on a fait, etc. etc. Merci beaucoup.
Hello, everybody. So first of all, I must apologize for two things. So the first thing is that I barely slept last night because of a baby boy that was born to us recently. And the second thing is that I lost my voice, also because of the baby boy, in fact. But so nonetheless, I hope I'm going to be able to give some clear talk. So the title of my talk is referring to two aspects of my relationship to Pierre, which is first that he was my professor, and then he was my PhD advisor, and we worked together on brain related issues, as I'm going to explain. But this title is also a blink of eye or clin d'œil to Pierre's career, because I think it sort of summarizes Pierre's trajectory, which started from a high energy theory and went towards a more gravity issue at the end of his career and life. Okay, so this picture were taken in Les Ouches in 1999, which he organized, and you can see that before his lecture. He was giving a lecture also there, and if I recall correctly, he was explaining some magical trick, and the reason for which he was explaining this trick was because of André Linde, who was also in this school. And André, in fact, we invited André to come here with Renata Kalosh, but they fortunately, they couldn't make it because of family reason. But André was is a very funny character, as you know, and he was giving us some magic trick the night before, probably, and then Pierre took up also to go to some magic trick there. And this illustrates for me one of the character of Pierre, which was he was always. He had some kind of childish part, which I liked very much, which he kept all his life, I think. So I am the only PhD student or ex-PhD student of Pierre to talk today, so I thought it was appropriate to mention the others. So this is the list. I think I didn't forget anybody except maybe the last one, Who I think is Frédéric Lamy. I'm not sure if he's in this room, but I think he started his PhD with Pierre, and fortunately he couldn't finish with Pierre. And if you look at the subject of the, in fact, of the thesis of the students of Pierre, it illustrates also Pierre's career in some way, because it started with subjects which are high energy subjects, and then ended with gravity subjects, eh? And in between there is some connection which is cosmology. So I first met Pierre he was my professor at the École Normale in, I think, 25 years ago. He was teaching special relativity at the time in the Master 1 of the École Normale. And then he was my professor at the DEA Master 2 CPM. And this is a picture of our promotion that was a year before Géraldine. And you recognize Luc Valentin here, who was the head of the DEA at the time. And I remember from this time, in fact, he was a very appreciated professor or teacher, as it was already said. And I have very good memories of his lecture, which were extremely clear always. And one thing which I remember from the time was that he gave us an exam, a final exam, which was a very nice format, because he gave us a problem. And we had, 24 hours to solve it, or maybe 48 hours even. And so with the result that we would go to see him during the weekend in his apartment, and to give him the result of our exam at the end. And it was, for me, it was a very nice experience. And in fact, this is the only exam of this type I got in my whole studies. Okay. I was lucky to be under his supervision for my PhD. And in fact, before starting my PhD, I met a lot of people. I was sort of not sure of what I wanted to do for my PhD, and I hesitated a lot, during my DOA and before, from subject ranging from neuroscience to experimental particle physics. That's why I went to this particular DOA, in fact, and then to theoretical physics, and then I decided sort of to, after having met a lot of people, to go with Pierre. And I think, in fact, preparing this talk, I sort of tried to understand why, beside, of course, the interest of the subject. And one thing which struck me at the time already was that he appeared to me as an extremely nice human being. I mean, I was, and that's something which was decisive, I think, in my choice of working with him. So this PhD was done in LPT in Orsay. So this is a picture of the lab now. I don't think it changed much from the outside, at least. So you see the cars. The cars are not the one of 20 years ago. And this slide is a copy of the slide of my PhD defense. So in fact, to prepare this talk, I digged out a lot of slides of this time. So all of the slides I'm going to show, all the handwriting slides, are sort of vintage from this time. So you see the subject of the PhD was cosmology, cosmological aspect of superstring theory. And I would like to give a little bit of context of this subject. So it was during between September 97 and until June 2000, and it was a very exciting time, as it was already mentioned by Géraldine. On the high energy side, it was just after what is called sometimes the second string revolution, and the discovery of the string web of dualities and the ADS-CFT correspondence. And there was, of course, a very important role played by so-called deep brain, which you can describe, schematically speaking, and if you want to use field theory language, as surfaces where some degrees of freedom are localized. And this will play a role in the rest of the talk. And on the cosmology side, it was also very exciting, of course, because it was just after the discovery of the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. And in fact, in the Les Ouches school, we, as I mentioned at the beginning, we had Rénal Pain come and explain the result. And I remember it was really a dramatic, of course, time for cosmology. And also, it was just before launch of WMAP mission. And so, and what has been called the advance of, or the start of precision cosmology. So it was, from this perspective, it was a very good timing for the interest of Pierre. And in fact, preparing this talk, I remarked that, in fact, those two papers were already mentioned by Marie Kay this morning for the first one, which is, I think, the first paper of Pierre, first published paper of Pierre. And the this one is the first paper of Pierre on which has a cosmological subject. And you see, they are very, I mean, they are close in time. And I think it seems that it was always an interest of Pierre, not only of working on high energy physics, but also on cosmology. And this timing, for that reason, this timing was very appropriate for Pierre interest, say. So I started my PhD in September 1997. And during the first months, I sort of tried to learn string theory from because the idea was to do string theory. And so I read the Green, Schwarz, Witten, etc. And I remember at the time, Pierre was already quite occupied, not probably as occupied as he was after when he was the director of APC, but he was still quite occupied by various things. But nonetheless, he always was available for answering my stupid questions, and I remember having discussed a lot of with him in his office in Orsay. And so after 1 year, we published two papers with one on cosmic strings with Patrick Peter, and another one with Emilian and Pierre on more stringy issues having to do with the strong coupling limit of the heterotic string. And then we move to some different subject, which is the one I'm going to explain today. So I'm going to explain today some aspect of some long, what I could describe as long-lasting fruits of a following paper, of this paper, which was published in 99, so in May 99, in fact. And so this is a paper already mentioned by Géraldine. And so maybe I should apologize for doing that because I'm one of the authors of the paper. But I guess I have three excuses to do that. The first one is that I was asked by the other organizers to do that. The second excuse is that it's the most cited paper of Pierre. As you can see, it has more than 1,000 citations. And there is another paper which we published in October of the same year with the same author plus Ulrich Elvanger, who's in the room, which also has about the same number of citations. And the third excuse is that it was published exactly 90 years ago, exactly, you see, on May the 3rd. And so we know what David was doing exactly 90 years ago. In fact, on my side, I think I was on vacation with my wife, with my fiancée at the time. I was trying to get vacation because I was very, I was following the process of putting the paper on the web, and I was very anxious about that. Okay, so this equation I'm going to, I mean, the fruit of which I would like to explain, this is the scientific part, say, of this talk, is this one. So it's very schematically. And so it's a bit abstract, maybe, for those of you who are not familiar with this subject. A less abstract version is this one, so which is supposed to be describing the cosmology, the equivalent of the Friedmann equation for a brain universe. So I'm going to explain this later on and some consequence of it. So this slide is just to flash it in a way. And I will come back to this equation later on. Okay, so before doing that, let me give a little context on this brain world. So this was following this string revolution. There was a series of very influential papers on the more phenomenological school, say, the first of which is probably the one of Gyat Vali, who's here today, and Nimar Kanyamen and Savas Dimopoulos in 98. And who basically took from the string construction the idea that we could live on some hypersurface, say, which is then called a brain, living in a higher dimensional bulk spacetime, which has more than four dimensions, and where gravity is living. And this paper was very influential. It was followed by Randall and Sundrum paper, which appeared just the day after our paper, in fact, here, as you see. And then a third influential paper was published by these people in 2 years after, and this is the so-called DGP model. So all these models are brain world models from written from a phenomenological and field theoretical point of view, and they were quite influential on the field. So when we started working on this subject, it was so before the publication of those two papers and after this. And we had in mind, in fact, things more related to string construction, like the Orjava-Witten gravity that I worked on with Pierre Ramon and Emilian Dudas at the time. So let me explain a little bit of the physics here. So in the ADD brain world, or that is to say this type of brain world, or this one, which is slightly different, I'm not going to explain the detail, but it turns out that gravity, if you look at the potential between sources which are localized on the brain, so you can compute the potential, the gravitational potential V of R between these sources, and you can easily find out that this potential behaves like in four dimension of 3+1 dimension at large distances. And you can, for example, in the case of Randall-Sundrum model, you can compute this coefficient here, which is in front of the M over R term, and interpret this as a Newton constant. So this coefficient, you see, is given by some parameter of the theory, and it will play a role in the following. Okay, so these results, however, were obtained by perturbation theory. That is to say, what you do is that you solve Einstein equation, basically, for this system, with a brain source, which is a delta function localized source of energy momentum. And if you want to compute this potential, you just put localized sources on the brain. And so you solve it for expanding around some background metric for some small perturbation, as you would do in a standard general relativity to get the Newtonian limit. So this was known, in fact, from the original papers of Randall and Sundrum or Arkaniamed, Dimopoulos, Valli. And it was obviously not very appropriate for cosmology, because for cosmology, what you really would like to do is to compute a solution of this equation, but for the background evolution or with non-localized sources, say, described by some energy density and pressure. And that's what we started to do with Pierre and David. And before going to the result, because I want to stress some aspect of this result. So to do that, I would like to say a few words on the geometry of this problem. It's nice, it has nice property. So again, the idea is that we live on this surface. And so if we are matter living on this surface, what we are sensitive to is only to the metric on this surface, and in particular, what is so-called the intrinsic curvature of this surface, which can be measured, for example, by the four-dimensional Einstein tensor, but computed with the metric living on this surface. However, this surface can be also given what is usually called an extrinsic curvature, just by embedding it in a different way in the embedding space. So this is a very simple example of that. It's well known. If you take a sheet of paper, it has zero intrinsic curvature, but you can give it an extrinsic curvature by turning it to a cylinder. But if you live on the surface, you cannot basically distinguish between those two cases, because locally everything is flat. I mean, so this is of course a very simplistic example, but this is the same is true in more general setting. And so to summarize, you have this 5D curvature that you can compute out of the Einstein equation in the bulk. Then you have the intrinsic curvature, that is the one you are sensitive to if you are matter living on the brain, and you have this extrinsic curvature. And then it turns out there is a geometrical identities between this quantity, which sometimes are called a Gauss identity or Gauss Kodaty identity. And one of them is this one, which relates the 5D curvature to the intrinsic curvature and to this this piece, which is quadratic, as you can see. It's quadratic into the extrinsic curvature. Okay. And then the next step, and this is instrumental in solving this equation, because you can show that the extrinsic curvature, when you have a distributional source like a brain, you can compute the extrinsic curvature as function of the energy momentum of this surface. And then you can plug it, you can plug this relation into this Gauss identity, and you find some equation that will relate, if you are in cosmology, for example, it will relate the Friedman term of the metric on the brain, which is contained here, to a term which is quadratic into the sources, whatever sources are localized on the brain. That's how we got this equation here. So you see that this structure I just showed, that there is a intrinsic Ricci scalar, which is or this one, this term, which is depicting the Friedman term on the brain. And then there is a term which is quadratic into the sources on the brain, this Crow square term, for example. And there is possibly also bulk sources. Okay. And one example of application of that was already mentioned by Giraldine, who after our paper with Christophe Grosjean and Jim Klein, applied this to Randall syndrome model to get this equation here. And I'm not going to explain the detail of it, but I want to stress one aspect of it. And this is this term here. This term is the first non-trivial term which is left over after you cancel this first term here, which is zero, in fact, in this model by some tuning relation. So this first term, it is a standard Friedman term, h square equal g newton, whatever, over 3 times rho, with a coefficient that you can read here, which is another way to define the Newton constant. So you see in this model, you can say you have different ways to define Newton constant. One way is to define it by perturbative calculation, and another way is to define it by cosmology, if you want. But it turns out that in this Randall syndrome model, the two ways exactly match. Okay, and so let me now go to another model, which is a DGP model, and which was proposed after our paper. And this is the start of a story which has to do with these fruits I was mentioning. So there in this DGP model, it was known by, in fact, from the calculation of DGP, that it has the peculiar behavior that in this model, the Newton potential is behaving as usual, that is to say in 3 plus 1 dimension at small distances, but it deviates from this behavior at large distances. And you can understand it in various ways, but in particular, this behavior can show that it is related to the fact that you have a graviton which is a resonance of massive graviton. You don't have a massless graviton. And in fact, as a result, you have a rescaling of the Newton constant from the one which appears in the action. So because a massive graviton exerts an extra force due to some scalar polarization, and so the force is stronger by a factor 4/3 if you just look at the potential. Okay, but then it turned out that if you look at the cosmology of this model and apply exactly the technique we derive in our 99 paper to this model, you can apply as well the technology we derive by just replacing now the source on the brain by an energy momentum tensor source plus another piece which is peculiar to DGP. And you see that if you equate, in fact, those two terms to zero, you get exactly the usual Einstein equation in 3D. This is a peculiarity of the DGP. But then if you go to cosmology, so you see, if you go to cosmology, or if you want to try to solve this equation for the curvature on the brain, you have a linear term here, and then you will have a term which is quadratic into the curvature, which is a peculiarity of this DGP. And as a result, the cosmology is solved by quadrature, and you get a quadratic equation to solve for the Friedman term. And this is a peculiarity of DGP. But there is a regime, nonetheless, where you go to the standard Friedman regime with exactly the usual normalization of the Newton's constant. So here, there is a mismatch between the perturbation theory, because in the perturbation theory, as I said previously, there is a renormalization of the Newton constant and the non-perturbative solution, the exact solution, where there is no such renormalization. That's the first thing I would like to stress. And the second thing is that because you have this quadratic equation to solve, you have two solutions, two branches. One is just a flat space-time, and the other one is an accelerating universe. That's the second peculiarity of this cosmology here. And in fact, this is the first fruit I would like to underline here, is that this, because of this self-accelerating branch, this model was the first concrete, I think, proposal to link the acceleration of the expansion of the universe to a large distance modification of gravity because of this feature. And this is a subject which sort of got a lot of attractions since then. And so I did a little toy exercise here to just, for example, look at correlation in a web of science between paper dealing with modified gravity and cosmology, and you see it's exploding. And this is also, even if you look at simply modified gravity, it's also there is a lot of interest for this subject. And I think probably the interest the graphic here is because of this idea that you can maybe get some interesting cosmology by modifying gravity at large distance as far as dealing with the dark energy is concerned, an idea for which this proposal linked to our 99 paper played, I think, an important role. Okay, so the second fruit is that it led, in fact, to a new phenomenology of scalar tensor theory via what is called the Galileans. And here again, this is a DGP model aspect of it, which mixed with our 99 paper. Because there you can show that in the DGP model you have a scalar sector which has a strong self-coupling interaction, and it has been shown that this scalar sector can be extracted by taking a so-called decoupling limit into this equation of motion. So this equation of motion is an equation for a scalar pi which is coupled to the trace of the energy momentum tensor, and there is a quadratic term here. And this quadratic term, you can trace it back exactly to this identity, this Gauss identity there. And this structure comes from this structure here. And so this line of thought has been generalized then to Galileans, which were proposed later, and covariant Galilean, and more recently some work on so-called Biondi-Ondesky and Dose theory, with the idea that you can... You want to reproduce some feature of this equation coming to DGP, and again if you follow the rope to the cosmology we derive in 99. Okay, and last fruit is this revival of massive gravity that I think this paper also is linked to. So the idea to try to give a mass to the graviton is old, it dates back to Fiers and Pauli, probably, and maybe even earlier. But there was various no-go theorems or obstacles on this way. So the first one is that it was shown in the 70s that a massive and a massless graviton yield drastically different physical results. For example, if you look at light bending, irrespectively of the mass of the graviton, if it's massive, then you would get completely wrong result in the solar system if you stick with the Fiers-Pauli theory. A way out of that was suggested by Arkady Weinstein in 72, but it was immediately criticized, and in fact a new obstruction were found by Boulware and Deser in 72 as well. And this subject sort of didn't make progress for a long time until the DGP cosmology, because the DGP cosmology provided the first example of interpolation between solution of a theory with massive graviton, which is this 5D behavior, to a solution which looks like theory of a massless graviton without this renormalization of fourth third that I was mentioning before. So So this you remember that renormalization of fourth third was discovered in the perturbation theory, and it's absent in the exact solution. And this was the basis of this paper, where we stress that it was in complete agreement with this qualitative agreement, at least with the Weinstein idea of 72. And this led to new efforts in the search of the consistent theory of massive gravity, because it seems to confirm this Weinstein idea and at least to overcome one of the criticisms of Boulware and Désert in 72. And this culminated in the recent discovery of a family of massive gravity that is devoid not only of this pathology discovered in the 70 by these people, but also which is devoid of another pathology discovered by Boulware and Désert, which I don't have time to explain. And this attracted also a lot of attention. If you look at the number of papers having to do with massive gravity, there is also some interest in that. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about the fruits of these equations, which I was probably schematic in explaining them, hopefully not too much. I would like to go back for the end of my talk to 99. So as I said already, this paper was published in May 99. And so one of the very nice memory I have of this time was the meeting with David Langlois, thanks to Pierre. And we had a lot of very nice physics discussion. And this result, I first presented them in the GDR supersymmetry, in fact, just a few days after, you see, in Marseille. So this is a transparency of my talk there. And I had also very good memories of this GDR supersymmetry, which for me was also a way to meet and to build links, which I still have with a community of experimental particle physics, which I enjoyed very much. So one of the places where we worked together with other people interested in the subject, including Ulrich, Jim Klein, Geraldine, and Christophe, was the so-called GPS. So unfortunately, Jean-François Grivaz and Laurent a little bit ruled out my joke there, but the GPS were meant to be a group de priorité supersymmetrique. And this is the web pages, which I understood today were resurrected for this occasion, of the GDR supersymmetry, where you see we had two GPSs, one having to do with extra dimension. And in fact, this GPS having to do with extra dimension, at the time, it didn't have anything to do with supersymmetry, but it was nice still to be able to be there and to discuss with these people. So of course, this GPS had a priori nothing to do with this other GPS that was already mentioned. Even though, in fact, preparing this talk, I discovered a picture which maybe makes me now suspicious that it had to do with it, because you see, this is a picture of Christophe Grosjean in Cargès, Corsica, right? In just a few months before this other GPS broke out. Okay, so to conclude, I would say that you know, working under the supervision of Pierre was very inspiring. Well, on the physics side, he was, and it has been already said, he was always optimistic, and which is opposite to me somehow, and it was very enriching for this reason. And also, he was very pleasant on the human side, and I think we all miss him a lot. So thank you for your attention.
Okay, I would like to start by thanking the organizers for this excellent initiative. On the other hand, it has been a very sad period. I think this is the fourth memorial conference I'm attending in a couple of years, with starting, I think, with Marchesini, Guido Altarelli, Roberto Petronzio, and then next September there will be one for Raul Gatto. So, well, it's very sad to see all these friends disappear. And of course, Pierre was the youngest of them all, and his departure was really very, very much premature. Now, this being said, let me start with a little preamble. I've never worked together with Pierre, but on a way we have followed similar professional trajectories. We both started as particle physicists, so I remember discussing supersymmetry with him at CERN when we were both playing with it. Later in our lives, we got involved in gravity and in cosmology, and I happened to be spending a year in Orsay, actually 2 years total, spread over two years because of a Pascal chair, and I enjoyed very, very much discussing with Pierre. It was just the time of this paper that was just discussed now by Cedric, and I remember that Pierre was organizing very lively meetings, weekly meetings in Orsay, and we had plenty of discussions about strings, cosmology. I mean, I had my own model, they had their model, comparing, discussing, and so on. And also, lately, we both got interested in gravitational waves, and I remember in that context, you know, meetings and discussions we had, particularly here at APC, where I was coming in general for committees or other seminars and so on. After one of these last committee meetings, he asked me whether we could see each other because he had some idea to discuss. He wanted to have my opinion on it. And he did come to Collège de France to meet with me, and we discussed. And I think it was about dark energy or the cosmological constant. He had a very, you know, an idea which was, you know, kind of revolutionary. To me, didn't look typical of Pierre, that one. I mean, it was a little bit too much, you know, exotic, let's say. and that was the last time we saw each other. So I thought, you know, I don't have so many things to say, and so much has been said by previous people on Pierre. So this will be more like a scientific talk. When I was asked to give a seminar here, I was thinking, what could I be talking about? And I thought that a theoretical talk on gravitational waves would be appropriate, at least to represent the theory side of Pierre's personality. Of course, as we heard, he had so many other very important sides. And I hope even that one day it might even become a physically relevant theoretical talk. In any case, I think that Pierre liked very much challenging problems, and so I hope to convince you that this is one of them. In fact, so much challenging that I'm not sure we got it right, and we certainly, I was hoping to finish this paper, well, actually before last week's seminar in Pisa, and certainly before this one, but we didn't. So this is really more like a progress report on some ongoing project. So in fact, it's about something which looks almost like a textbook exercise that you should be able to find solved in any book in general relativity. It's considered a collision of two massless or, say, highly relativistic particles. So we are not talking about those guys in the picture, or you have to imagine that the star is a particle, is a relativistic particle, and even the The black hole is this tiny black hole, and they move against each other with basically the speed of light. So a particular case, but we will not restrict ourselves to this, is the one in which the scattering itself is gravitational. So if two particles, two massless particles collide at impact parameter B, and with center of mass energy E, the Einstein formula tells you that in this case there is a deflection angle, which is 2R over B. I will always use C equal 1 units. And the problem is to compute the gravitational wave spectrum associated with such a collision, at least to lowest order in the deflection angle. And I remember I was at NYU, and one day we were chatting with Andrei Gruzinov there, and I mentioned this question to him because we had some puzzles with Amati and Cefaloni about this this calculation, and his reaction was, how can it possibly be an unsolved problem? So we started to email colleagues, ask friends, and so on, and nobody really could provide an answer. For instance, we would ask even numerical relativity people, and they explained to us that it's very difficult to do this numerically, because when two massless particles collide and they emit gravitational radiation, of course the gravitational wave travels with the speed of light, but so do the particles themselves, since they are massless. And it's very difficult numerically to disentangle the shock wave of a massless particle, because it has its own metric, and the gravitational radiation itself. So it was challenging, both theoretically and numerically. Now, how can you what do you expect? I mean, suppose that the massless limit does exist. We believe it does. And also the classical limit exists for this process. I think these are modest assumptions. Then in that case, if you can really neglect quantum effects, then the parameter space for the process will be just the energy of the collision and the scattering, the deflection angle. And as a function of these two parameters, we'd like to compute, well, as much as we can. So, for instance, the frequency, and why not also the angular distribution of the gravitational radiation. For instance, if we look just at the frequency spectrum, we expect this to be given by the Newton constant times E square times a function of the angle and of, say, omega r, r being the gravitational radius. The other thing, which would follow more or less from the previous one, will be an interesting quantity is the power or luminosity, dE over dt, which should have the units of the inverse Newton constant times, again, a function to be computed of the deflection angle and, say, of time, T here is time, over R. There is an interesting conjecture about luminosity to be always bound by the inverse of the Newton constant. This is sometimes called the Dyson bound, and we will encounter it later on in this talk. Certainly, it is true that E over T has the same dimensions as the inverse Newton constant. Now, and finally, the total gravitational wave yield of efficiency, what is the total E in gravitational waves divided by the total center of mass energy. Now, at the quantum level, the Planck mass can appear, and also through h bar, you can have a dependence on h bar omega. And the emergence of a classical limit from the quantum calculation should be very instructive. As we will see, there is, sorry for this acronym explained later, is a zero frequency limit which is known, and I will describe it in a moment, and it's classical, but the corrections order omega and omega square, we will see are usually quantum, even if you take the ultra-relativistic limit. So they depend typically on ratios like h bar omega divided by e or h bar omega divided by q, the momentum transfer in the process. Now, however, if we go to extremely high energies, and I have been playing with this game of a Gedanken experiment for a while, even to the transplanckian energy regime, then the correction should become again classically and only depend on powers of omega r or omega b, where b is the impact parameter. So can we see all this realized in practice, in a calculation? So I mentioned this ZFL, or zero frequency limit, which is an old story going back to the 70s, and it's a very good theoretical and solid prediction about how dE over d omega goes for zero frequency. It can be obtained in different ways. For as a particle theorist, I prefer to do it from a quantum argument, which we will repeat in a moment in some detail. Let me only state the result here. For a 2-to-2 scattering after integrating over angle, the result, as I said already, is classical and is given by this little formula. As promised, it depends on g times e squared, and it has a dependence on the deflection angle. It goes to zero when the angle goes to zero. If there is no deflection, there is no radiation, and it has this precise, interesting form. So with this preliminary, let me say that this was supposed to be the outline. Now I realize that instead of being ahead, we are late, right? Yeah, so maybe I'll try to shorten some parts, or at least skip formulae. Now, the talk is supposed to be in two parts. One is how to go beyond the zero frequency limit using soft graviton theorems. So we would like to see what are the corrections to the constant. Notice that the limit of zero frequency is a constant, independent of frequency. We would like to look at the corrections of order omega and why not omega square. We think that they are within theoretical reach because of soft graviton theorems, but this is the part where we are still a little bit stuck. Well, you'll see, in certain situations. And then the second part of the talk is going to higher frequency for small deflection angles, and that's older work. And eventually, we would like to see how the two regimes can be matched one with the other. So it's a very concrete problem. There's no fancy theory. It's just general relativity. Well, there will be some quantum gravity, but we use only some effective way of quantizing gravity, or you can think of being within string theory, and this the result should not depend very much on how the ultraviolet is regularized. Okay, so the first part is going to be, so this is work in progress with Andrea Dasi and Massimo Bianchi, and I put a star that the results are somewhat preliminary. Maybe I shouldn't be talking about this, but I couldn't resist the temptation. So there were old theorems on soft photons and gravitons going back to the 60s, and they had a revival recently. This is an interesting work by Andriy Strominger and Cajazzo, Zvi Bern, Di Vecchia, Bianchi, many other people. Also, there are recent papers by Ashok Sen and collaborators. Now, in the case of gravitons, on which we concentrate here, if we consider an arbitrary process where, for simplicity, we take spinless particles colliding, but doesn't have to be 2 to 2, then the amplitude for emitting an extra soft graviton is known beyond leading order. Okay. So you see, this is an expansion in powers of Q, where Q is the momentum of the emitted gravitons. The first term is of order 1 over Q. The second is of order Q to the 0. The third is of order Q to the first power. And the leading term is very simple because it multiplies the amplitude without emission by a factor. The corrections are a little bit more subtle because they involve an operator which acts on the no emission amplitude. That operator is very nice because it contains the angular momentum, okay, up to an I, which for simplicity we leave out of the definition. This is the angular momentum operator because d by dp is x. Okay, so this is xp minus px antisymmetric. So, however, there is a word of warning, and this is that unlike the leading term, the subleading and sub-subleading terms may need corrections when you include loops and when the process have infrared singularities, which unfortunately does in four dimensions. So, at some point, we will be walking on thin ice. Okay. We have to be careful. So, this is the rederivation of the zero frequency limit in this particular m going to zero limit. Okay, I don't have to go through the mathematics. It's late. You're all probably very tired. But of course, the leading term is just, for the cross section, is just the absolute square of the leading term, nothing else. And then there is some algebra that you have to do. You have to sum over the polarization of the gravitons. This is done here. And then you have to integrate over the phase space, the angular integral, if you are interested just in the frequency spectrum. And this can be done. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. And this is given by this formula. So you have to sum over all the pairs I and j in the initial and final states. Pi dot pj is the usual Mandelstam variable. And there is a log of pi dot pj. Now, the nice thing about this formula, which is repeated here, is that it is smooth in the massless limit. Okay, I took the massless limit. Term by term, you have to regularize actually an infinity, but when you sum over I and j, you see immediately that the log of mu squared disappears because sum over I and j, pi pi j, is zero. Okay? Because the sum of the pi is zero. I take the convention in which all the momenta are incoming, so the sum of all momenta adds up to zero. This is convenient. And that's the formula, the general formula, which if you go to the 2 to 2 case, you can work it out. It gives this formula, s log s plus t log t plus u log u. And the particular case I was mentioning before is going to small t, use s plus t plus u equals zero, and that's how you get that result. But you see, this is more general, and this is also more general for 2 to 2. So this is a solid starting point. How do you go on from there? Well, next to leading, you have to interfere the leading and the next to leading in the amplitude. Then, all of a sudden, this angular momentum operators appear, but, okay, you can start still to do the integration over Q as before with a little problem that these integrals typically have some collinear singularities, but they cancel again. So I'll go a little bit quickly because also of time. The final result for the correction takes this slightly more complicated form, but still very explicit and quite nice. For instance, well, sorry, it probably takes time to read it all. So instead of gs, you get g square root of s h bar omega. You see that you get an h bar in the result. And then a prefactor, which is nice because, again, the logs, you see there is no mass regulator in the log. If you are worried that this s tilde, which is defined here, can go to zero, it can, but the log vanishes exactly where the denominator vanishes. So this formula is perfectly regular, and you are left with these derivatives with a set of the momenta with errors, because now it's an interference between s and s dagger, or a and a dagger, and the derivative can act on either side. And the amusing thing is that when you specialize to the case of 2-2-2 scattering, with an argument that I will not even read, but if you want, you can read it fast, gives zero. Okay? So we wanted to, especially our younger member of the collaboration, wanted to write a paper on the first order correction, but since we got zero, we convinced him that we should go to next order. He was very disappointed. So we went to next order, and of course the calculation is much more involved, but at least it's not zero. And this is the result written for an arbitrary process, all massless, but still arbitrary. And now you see it contains, all terms contains two derivatives because there are two angular momentum operators. However, now you can get, of course, a contribution either for the square, from the square of the first order correction, or from the interference between the leading and the next to next leading term. The square of the first order is obviously positive, but not so the interference. So the question is, what is the final result? And this formula, okay, took us quite a lot of time to get all the signs right, all the factors of two right. It's really a little bit of a nightmare, at least at my age, but I guess even at their age. And I'll only show you what it reduces to for 2-2-2 scattering, because after all, from a practical, let's say, point of view, it's the most interesting case. So this summarizes the result. So if you want the spectrum for gravitational wave emission, is obtained by taking all these operators between the S and S dagger, and then you divide by the probability of the process without emission. And there is an overall factor, which now is G H bar omega all squared. Okay. And this formula is quite nice. For instance, you see these derivatives with respect to S, T, and U appearing always in combinations which are unambiguous. Namely, there is a whole question of how you interpret exactly these derivatives with respect to the momenta, given the fact that the momenta are constrained. So what do you keep fixed when you take a derivative? Well, here, the good news is that it doesn't matter. Okay, if you decide that the four-point function is given in terms of S and T, or S of U, or T and U, these combinations of derivatives don't care, okay? They give always the same result. Also, other nice things are that these precise combinations of logs kill some otherwise super-leading contributions. So there are cancellations between, say, for instance, the log of minus U over S is the log of 1 plus T over S. So 1 plus T over S. So a small t, this is a small log, and this t over s combines with this prefactor to give a ut, which nicely combines with another term and so on. So it has very nice properties. So why don't we apply this to a case? So for a three level, there is absolutely no problem, and we get perfectly nice results. For instance, we took an example. The scattering of A plus B goes to A plus B with a, exchanging a graviton. Okay, this is a process, say, for dark matter, which very light dark matter, which has only gravitational interactions. This will be the leading process for the four-point function, okay? If you believe in very light dark matter. Now, we apply the operator, and we find that it is proportional. I mean, this B2 is just the square of this. So applying our formula, we end up saying that the correction is 14 to be confirmed, okay? Because I'm not sure the other two guys have checked it. This is my result. So I take responsibility for the 14. Times this. So if you compare the correction to the leading order term, the zero frequency term, this will be of order h bar omega squared divided by t up to a log, or h bar squared omega over q squared. Now, if you identify 1 over q with the impact parameter, h bar over q with the impact parameter, this actually becomes of this order, which is an interesting thing. I mean, we believe that the range of validity of the zero frequency limit is really one of the impact parameter, both in this case and in the classical case. But when we tried to apply this same formula to what we believe to be the Trans-Planckian scattering of two massless particles at large impact parameters, we run into problems. Now, here I had inserted a couple of slides to tell you about how, for the last 30 years, we have been dealing with this process, with this elastic process, before adding gravitational radiation. Now, again, I don't know whether I should spend much time on it, but this is just a nice story. We were able, with Amati and Cefaloni, to resum ladder diagrams and to describe this process in a very simple semi-classical way. The S-matrix is given by the exponential of a action divided by h-bar to leading order. And this formula reproduces many nice things, like the Einstein's deflection formula. It can be extended, as you can see, to arbitrary number of dimensions. For four dimensions, the case we are interested in here, you have to think of this as a log. And it's important that the phase is given, by the energy times the time delay divided by h bar. Now, why I'm insisting on this is because now if we apply our formula to this kind of amplitudes, the derivatives will act on the exponentials precisely like in WKB, right? There will be prefactors, but if you act on the prefactors, you don't gain a 1 over h bar, whereas the leading terms is when the derivatives act on the exponent and bring down factors of 1 over h bar. And so superficially, it works perfectly well that these corrections become classical. So although they had an h bar in front, because they act on something which is of order 1 over h bar, they reduce to a classical correction. There is a problem that when we do this, everything looks nice except that there is an infinite Coulomb phase which doesn't drop out. Namely, the infinite Coulomb phase is really this guy in four dimensions. This is a log, and the log has to be regularized by something, or we have to say what is the scale. And usually, this is the famous Coulomb infinite phase, which you can find in Landau-Lifschitz, which usually doesn't affect physical quantities, like the deflection is the derivative with respect to the impact parameter, and that deflection doesn't care about what is under the log. But mysteriously, we get this infinite Coulomb phase appearing in the answer. So we tried all sorts of things, but so far we couldn't get rid of the infinity. Now, based on the results in part two of my talk, I think this confirms that the naive recipe which we used has corrections for loop amplitudes and or infrared divergences, but there have been proposals in the literature of how to deal with this correction. So we are not losing any hope to be able to deal with this problem, and then it will be nice because then we will find what is the classical limit of the process. How much time do I have? Maybe a few minutes. Huh? So in part two, I'd like to say something about what we have been doing previously, actually, on higher frequencies. So I told you the story of Gruzinov. It didn't end there. I mean, we realized that people had not solved the problem, so we decided to try to solve it ourselves. And in fact, a few months later, we came up with this paper, and which is completely classical. There is no quantum mechanics here. It's only Huygens' principle in some so-called Fraunhofer approximation. And this is a picture of how you use Huygens' principle in the case of gravity, because you see you have to superimpose several waves emitted by points in your screen. However, on top of some trivial geometrical factors on the phases, you have to account also for the phase due to the time delay of general relativity. And when all this is done, we get a very nice explicit formula, not only for the angular, for the frequency, but also for the angular distribution. Again, I will not go into the details. You know, this integral d2x is precisely the integral over all the screen. The screen is the plane on which the two shock waves meet. Okay, before they meet, nothing happens. This you can prove. It's an exact solution of general relativity for massless particle only. Then nothing happens until the two particles meet. But from there on, a lot of things happen. And again, this formula is quite nice and has some nice properties, like, you know, this dangerous singularities at x equals 0 is compensated by this by this factor, and so on and so forth. Now, I will tell you in a moment what it gives, this formula, okay? But I want to mention that later on, we approached this problem with Cefaloni and his collaborator called Ferrai, and then another collaborator, Koraldeschi, and magically, we confirmed this result from a quantum calculation, which is an improvement of the Amati, Cefaloni, and myself treatment. You know, there are interesting issues, like, for instance, the fact that whereas Weinberg's formula for the emission of soft gravitons takes only into account the emission of gravitons from the external lines, we have to add the emission from internal lines, which in this case go almost on shell, so they behave effectively almost like external, and we have to do so for not so soft gravitons, which we are interested in, and other technical details. An interesting point, and this is where maybe we get a hint on how to solve the previous problem, we should take into account that there is a finite difference between two infinite Coulomb phases. The Coulomb phase, due to the two-particle state, the rescattering of a two-particle state through graviton exchange, and then if you take the final state to consist of of your original two-particle plus a graviton, you have to put in the final state phase for the three-particle state. Now, they're both infinite, but the difference between the two is finite. It's fine. And this is what regulates the Coulomb singularity effectively, so that the final result is... So I think we should learn from this what to do in the other cases. But, you know, I was thinking about it even during some talk. So this is how it works. It's quite interesting that using energy and momentum, angular momentum conservation, and keeping all the phases, you end up with a finite contribution. And that finite contribution contains precisely that function phi of x, which we got from the classical thing, except that you have to take the limit, where it's written, here, h bar omega over e much less than 1, okay? I mean, this formula is a little more general because there are still h bars, but if you take the classical limit, you fall back on the previous formula. Just exactly the same formula. So we started to really believe in it, so I will end up telling you what this formula gives in terms of the gravitational wave spectrum. And unfortunately, as I told you, we cannot yet compare this approach to the other one because of that Coulomb singularity that we are still unable to get rid of. So the spectrum looks like that. That between so we are at small deflection angles, so the impact parameter is much bigger than the Schwarzschild radius of the process. That means b to the minus 1 smaller than r to the minus 1. In the interval between these two scales, we find the spectrum to be given by this formula with a mild logarithmic dependence on omega. This formula would diverge at omega equals 0, but gets regulated when omega is of order b to the minus 1, then this becomes r over b, and r over b is the deflection angle. And that's how we reproduce exactly the zero frequency limit in this framework. So what is nice, which I think is the most interesting thing of this exercise, is that there is a break precisely at omega equal r to the minus 1, namely, above r to the minus 1, I put Hawking, exclamation point, because this is the frequency of a Hawking radiation, okay? If you multiply by h bar again, you find the Hawking temperature, roughly, up to numerical factors. And so we find, just from this calculation, that there is a break in the spectrum. So instead of being almost constant or logarithmically constant, the spectrum starts to go down. There is a break in the spectrum. And the spectrum becomes this. Now, this is very nice to get somehow from a calculation from scratch. You get this scale in the process. However, if you integrate out the spectrum over omega to find the total yield, of course, it diverges. It diverges logarithmically. So if you put an extra cutoff by hand at some omega star, you get an efficiency which goes like log omega star. Now, however, we know that that formula with this Fraunhofer approximation and other approximation we made, we linearized some Einstein equation, cannot hold beyond, starts to be suspicious above this scale. Now, it so happens that this scale coincides with where you threaten this bound. I told you about this luminosity bound, which nobody has proven, but there is, by the way, a recent paper by Vitor Cardoso et al., which says that under some conditions on the initial state, which seem to be satisfied in a scattering problem, I think they argue that this formula may be correct. Okay, this bound may be correct. So if you don't change this behavior above this frequency, you know, short times are related to high frequencies, of course. So if you let this formula go beyond this omega, then you get at very short times a power or a luminosity which exceeds this bound. So there are all indications that this may be an absolute place where you should put an extra break in the spectrum. And in fact, in the paper with Grusinov, we argue that the spectrum should go from 1 over omega to 1 over omega square around this value. And the nice thing about this, maybe this was an observation that Gia made to Grusinov, I'm not sure, I think he told me so, an omega to the minus 2 spectrum is very interesting. You'd say, oh no, a black hole doesn't have an omega to the minus 2 spectrum. It doesn't if you look at the evaporation at one point, because it's a Planckian spectrum, so it goes down exponentially. But if you integrate over all times of a black hole lifetime its spectrum, then in the end you end up precisely with an omega to the minus 2 spectrum. So we, as you see, we have still open problems both on this part of my talk and on the other. Well, I ended up with some nice pictures, just to show that we really could, that this formula for the for the spectrum, you know, you can really compute it numerically, and you get, this is the agreement between the high frequency and then how it goes to the zero frequency limit. This is a check that formula reproduces the zero frequency limit. And you see the break occurring here, but if you go to, the break is not at omega equal r to the minus 1, it's already, the bending occurs before because, well, now I forgot because I think of this definition. But as you go towards bigger and bigger angle, it approaches precisely r to the minus 1. And, you know, we have also angular distributions, different values of omega r, all sorts of things. Fizrev liked very much our picture, and they put it in some art, I don't know. Okay, so summarizing. I think the gravitational waves from ultra-relativistic collisions is an interesting, though probably academic, theoretical problem. Could be of interest, perhaps in the early universe or with mini black holes, who knows. It's challenging, both analytically and numerically, I explained why, and both classically and quantum mechanically. The ZFL is classical and well understood. The sub and sub-sub leading corrections start to be understood, but still you need some work. Eventually, these ZFL results and beyond should be matched to those obtained by other methods. And the large omega cutoff is still purely understood. And it could be related to this maximal luminosity conjecture. And with this, I thank you all, and particularly Pierre, for all he has given to physics and to France and to many, many of us. Thank you.